Welcome back to this exciting instalment of the Pendulum saga. There's good news and bad news, so the jury's still out, I'm afraid. The good news is that at least it made an attempt at working. The bad news is that it wasn't that impressive, and it also uncovered some flaws in the design strategy. There's still hope, though, more details later, although I won't know the outcome for a few weeks. Firstly, something I forgot to mention last time, just in case you were planning on using these Hall Effect sensor modules. Now, I'd made the naive assumption that because they contained additional components, such as this voltage comparator chip, the signal transitions would be nice and clean. And when I connected it to an interrupt pin on the controller, it thought the pendulum was going like the clappers. Now, this scope trace shows why. This is a typical transition from low to high, and these glitches were the culprits. And the solution was very easy, just a small capacitor across the digital output. In my case, 10 nanofarads removed the glitches completely. Okay, back to the project. Here's the shelf in the hallway, which is high enough to test a 2.5 metre pendulum. And the first problem I had was the driver motor did not have enough power to get it started. I removed the 0.5 kilogram weight, as the aluminium bar is now simulating the weight for the target design, but it still seemed to struggle. I then found that using micro-stepping with a stepper motor decreases its torque quite severely. I knew it reduced it, but did not realise how drastic it was. I'd been using 16th steps with the small pendulum to provide a smooth push, but have since discovered this reduces the torque to about 10%. So I'm now using quarter steps, which is about 40% torque, and this seems adequate to at least get the pendulum started. The more serious issue is that the timings from the sensor are not as consistent as I thought, so the controller is sometimes unable to deduce where the pendulum is and either backs off pushing it or gets out of sync. Now, this seems to be due to the swing period being dependent on the swing amount, maybe compounded by friction in the bearing, and also the sensor triggers at slightly different points as the magnet moves across it. This means left to right timings are not the same as right to left, so the controller software needs to do more calculations to compensate. The bottom line is that I decided to abandon these sensors and replace them with a rotary one as used on the stepper motors for the clock hands. The software would then know the absolute position of the conrod at all times instead of trying to deduce it from on-off transitions. And the problem with this, as touched on earlier, is the lack of space. But I was telling myself what it really needed was a one-way clutch, and bizarre as it sounds, I had a 50-year-old flashback to the mid-70s when I was trying to fix a washing machine. I'd stripped it all down and remember finding a strange device inside which looked like a conventional ball bearing or ball race, never quite sure of the terminology. And it behaved very oddly. If you turned the inner cylinder one way, it rotated freely as expected with the bearing. But if you turned it the opposite way, it locked solid with the outer cylinder. I remember being fascinated as I couldn't work out how it could possibly work. I was familiar with one-way ratchets, like those used on old push bikes. This allows the pedals to drive the back wheel in one direction, but when you stop pedaling, the wheel rotates freely. And the ratchet gives the familiar clacking sound as the spring-loaded metal flaps ride over the ratchet steps. But this strange bearing was as smooth as silk. So what exactly was it, and had I dreamt it? And would you believe it, after all this time, a quick search for one-way clutches showed they do exist, also under the name of sprag clutches, another new word for me, and you can look them up to see how they work. The beauty is that one of these could replace the driver bar and magnet holders completely, and would also make room for a rotary sensor. The motor spindle would need locking to the inner cylinder and the conrod to the outer. When the motor turns one way, it would drive the conrod, and when the motor is de-energized, the conrod is free to rotate in either direction. Now, in one direction, it would also be moving the motor, but as long as it's not energized during this period, there's no danger of it losing sync. And even if it does and starts moving in the opposite direction, it would have no effect on the conrod or anything else, unlike the current driver bar, which has limited travel. So I'm now waiting for a sprag clutch to be delivered, and we'll post a follow-up video later. Bye for now.